Good afternoon. I have the pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Tippy Irwin. She's the Executive Director, Ombudsman Services of San Mateo County Incorporated. Tippy joined the staff of Ombudsman Services in October of 2001. She has a Bachelor of Science in Business Management. She has been working in the aging field for over 20 years. Prior to coming to the Bay Area, she started the Volunteer Caregivers Program in the small Appalachian town where she lived in upstate New York, providing in-home supportive services to frail elderly clients. The program is still going on and is spread across three counties. Tippy is responsible for the day-to-day management of the Ombudsman Services and staff oversight. Under her direction, the program has grown from handling 750 complaints per year to handling approximately 2,000 per year. She has done this through expanding the responsibilities of the volunteer field ombudsmen, building them into a highly trained, skilled team of professionals that support the work of the program. Tippy has a broad vision of the role of Ombudsman Services of San Mateo County as an integral part of the continuum of care for the community's elderly and disabled adults, forming coalitions with a variety of stakeholders, agencies to firmly take its place as a community builder. Please join me in extending a warm welcome to Tippy Irwin.
Thank you, Linda. So good afternoon to everybody. It's great to be here and to have the opportunity to bring to you the Ombudsman Perspective. First of all, I just need to warn you, I came back from Australia the day before yesterday and my synapses are not firing on full function. I was up at 3:30 this morning when my body was telling me to get up and clean the house. So bear with me. When we meet new people, it's pretty much a standard response to, or standard question to be asked. So what do you do? It's kind of the opener for small talk, right? And when I respond that I'm the Director of Ombudsman Services of San Mateo County, they get this bewildered look across their face and say, what's that? Most people have difficulty pronouncing the word ombudsman. And then when I explain that we are actually not ombudsmen, which implies neutrality, but we are actually advocates for residents in long-term care facilities in the county. That we make approximately 5,000 drop-in visits a year to the 516 long-term care facilities. That we receive 2,000 complaints a year, which we investigate and then attempt to bring resolution to those complaints. Then I'm met with, that's followed by another barrage of questions, starting something like this. How can you work in this field? Isn't it depressing? Working with all these people that have been warehoused? And my response is immediate and spontaneous. Absolutely not. I could not have stayed in the job 14 years if I found it depressing. In the work we do in this field, and by we, I mean you and me, we are all obviously working in this field or we would not be here today, at least that's my guess. We cannot afford to be jaded. We cannot afford to lose our passion or our compassion. This work can suck you dry, and I'm sure many of you have felt that way on occasions. Be good to yourself. Surround yourself with good people, because if you choose well and you choose wisely, those very people will be the ones that fuel you, that provide you with the food that you need, with the encouragement that you need to continue, the ability to weather the losses, and they will encourage you to celebrate whatever successes you have, big and small. I call on every one of you to bring authenticity to the work that you do. Be a leader by fostering leadership in your wake. If you are a caregiver in a facility, how many facilities are represented here today? Because obviously that's where my interest, hands up so I can see you. Not a whole lot. I'm sorry about that, because I really, this is something that I feel that this is more geared to people that are working in facilities or even as caregivers. So I'm sure there are many caregivers here today. How many of you would consider yourself caregivers? More hands raised. That's good. So if you are in a position, you're working for a company and a new staff person is hired, understand that the responsibility that you have and the privilege of engendering in that person compassion and the vision to see the individual that you're serving as whole and complete, just as they are. A precious soul to be respected and to be treated every day with dignity. And if you're working if you're working as a caregiver, remember that you're a guest in a host environment. By that I mean that you are in the home of the individual that you are serving, whether it's a facility or a home, it's still their home. And that you're there only at the invitation of the person you are serving or their legal responsible party. What is our obligation? And somebody else asked this earlier on. I thought it was interesting because I had the same question. What is our obligation to this elderly population? That's a very big question, and we could spend a whole day just discussing it. But I'm here to give you the Ombudsman perspective. At the risk of repeating what you may have already been told many times before, I want to emphasize two particular points for those of you who are working with this extremely vulnerable group of people. Firstly, I suggest that whenever you engage with an individual with dementia, that you leave behind you at the door any negative emotions that you may have or any preconceptions. It may seem that the individual has checked out, that they are no longer able to communicate with us. We see the vacant eyes, and there doesn't seem to be much behind them. It seems that they are lost to the world. But let me tell you, the minute you step inside that room, they have antennae that pick up any negative emotions or any emotions that you bring with you. They have not lost, that's one of the abilities that they keep up until probably the very close to the end of their lives. They still are able to pick up on whatever emotions they come into contact with. If you come into the room agitated, rushed, annoyed, their antennae will pick up that immediately and your ability to work with that client is diminished. When this is happening, I suggest that you leave the room and you do a personal inventory before you choose to go back. And if you go back, you can't go back into that room with the idea that maybe Mrs. Smith is now ready to let me change her without a fuss. That's not going to happen. If your attitude is the same as it was when you left, you're going to meet with exactly the same response. Remember that the only person you have to work with is yourself. And if you really seriously want to bring about change in another, you need first of all to shift your own attitudes. So the second point I want to make, or to emphasize, is that what we term behaviors are often the only form of communication that these folks have. Eliminating the behaviors by drugging or any other means is like eliminating their last line of communication. To work effectively with clients with dementia, it's imperative to get behind the behaviors or the words that they're saying, which we may not understand, to determine what it is the individual is trying to communicate. I'm going to tell you just a little brief story here before I start my slides. Some years ago, we had a case involving a woman with dementia who was in a dementia facility. She complained to the staff that her husband had stolen all her money. And the staff shrugged it off. But she continued to complain. And again, the staff would shrug it off for months, actually. They shrugged it off, saying, what does she know? She's lost the plot. She has dementia. Her husband's here every day. He brings her little gifts when he comes. How could he possibly have stolen all her money? And then they turned it over to the ombudsman after this complaint never went away. It just kept coming back and coming back. And they finally turned it over to the ombudsman who was assigned to that facility. And the ombudsman began an investigation. And what she discovered was that this man, her husband, had been the victim of financial fraud. And he'd been bilked of all his retirement savings. The wife's perception that he had stolen all her money came from the fact that he had stopped bringing her those small gifts. So she knew something had shifted. And the only way she had to communicate it was to say, he's stolen my money. But the idea, of course, is that we have to get behind what the spoken words are to what the actual meaning is. And I ask that when you're dealing with clients with dementia, that you do this with every client that is exhibiting behaviors or saying things that you think are meaningless. Usually there's some meaning behind them. So, okay, I've got to manage this little gadget. Whoa, step one, that's a good thing. What I've done is I've put together a few cases here, and we'll just go as far as we can go in the time that we have. Understand, first of all, that these cases are not simple. I can't put them into three sentences or four sentences, so bear with me. We're going to talk about George. Age 92, is currently living in a nursing home. Prior to coming to the facility, he had lived alone in his own home. He's an alcoholic suffering from alcohol-related dementia. He's also diagnosed with personality disorder. He has only been in the facility a few months, and from the start, the staff have found him very difficult to manage. His behaviors were compounded by the fact he was taken advantage of by the social worker at the facility, to whom he had entrusted his bank card so she could draw money for him. She absconded with his card and stole money from his account. That matter is being dealt with by both local law enforcement and the district attorney's office. As far as George is concerned, any trust that existed between him and the staff has evaporated. George is constantly yelling at the staff to get out of his room, throwing anything that comes to hand, including tossing urine from his urinal at them. None of the staff want to go near him, and who can blame them? The ombudsman was called to see if we could assist. The administrator did not want Judith, our ombudsman, to go into the room alone, but she felt it was the right way to go, considering the breakdown in the relationships between George and the staff. The administrator escorted her to the door and then stood just out of view as she spoke to George. Judith went in very carefully and was immediately yelled at, "What do you want? Get out of here." At a safe distance, Judith responded, "I'm an ombudsman. I'm your friend. I'm here to help you. If you have any problems in the facility..." George began to open up. He informed her that his phone does not work and that he cannot call his brother. If you want to help me, get me a phone, he said, now. Judith's response was, "I can't promise to do that." "Yes, you must. I call my brother two or three times a week." In order to befriend him, Judith took out her cell phone and said, "Let's call your brother now." She got the brother on her phone and then passed it to George, who spoke with his brother for several minutes. He gave the phone back and continued to yell at Judith. I have to understand that George at this point didn't know how to speak in anything but a yelling voice. "Now you must get me my own phone." Judith told him she could not help him if he continued to yell at her. He calmed down, and they agreed she would work on finding a way to get him a phone. The administrator met her as she exited and agreed that the nursing home will provide him with a cell phone until his finances are straightened out. So what are the issues? The first issue that I think we raise almost with every case that we come across is the client a danger to himself or others? In this case, I would suggest that he well might be. If he's throwing things, he could quite easily injure a staff. Tossing urine is certainly not a behavior that I would wish to encourage. Approach the individual carefully. If the behavior continues and the staff are unable to turn the situation around, it might be that they'll need to call 911, but not yet. So what's the logical next step? And you notice I have a question mark here, a psych evaluation? Maybe not. He's diagnosed already. He's diagnosed with mental health issues, and he's being treated under a psychiatrist for those issues. So we probably don't need to call for a psych eval at this point. They're very conscious of where he's at and what he's up to. However, it would not hurt to have a discussion and get some guidance from his psychiatrist. So that's always an option, is to pick up the phone and call the psychiatrist. Perhaps ask for an evaluation of his medications. This might be a route we wish to follow if we're not able to bring resolution to the problem at hand. But before any changes are made, let's go a little bit further. One of the other considerations that we might look at is what has changed in George's environment. And at the beginning, I mentioned that he'd only been in the facility a few months. A few months in the span of 92 years, however old George is, I think we said he was 92, is not much time to adapt to anything new. So he's still in the adaptation phase of his stay in the facility. So that needs to be taken into consideration as we're dealing with him. Always approach the clients with a clean slate. Never go by what others tell you about a client. Meet the individual with a clean slate before you determine whether he is or is not a difficult client. We're not suggesting that our client is not difficult, far from it. We're suggesting that with the right attitude, maybe you can find a way to communicate effectively with him. What is behind the current behavior? The facility had not been able to determine that his major anxiety at this point was about not being able to contact his brother. He used to speak to his brother two or three times a week, and now he can't call him at all. When dealing with behaviors, every attempt should be made to get to the root cause of the behavior. I'd like to make a suggestion that maybe, and we don't have all the answers by any long chalk, but these are suggestions I'm making. Maybe assigning the same staff or the same team of staff, because you've got three shifts, the same team of staff to the same individual day by day by day by day starts to enable relationships to develop between the staff member and the clients. If there's a turnover of staff, constant turnover of staff, there's no time for the staff to get to know the individuals. So consistent assignments are an essential part of what we call resident-centered care, which I'm sure you're all aware of. I hope you are. Very important, there's relationships. I'm suggesting that if you do have a consistent team of caregivers, then when some sort of episode happens, there's generally one caregiver that has a strong working relationship with the individual and can bring about some influence. And that would be the one to call up and say, can you come and help us here? We're having some difficulty with George. Maybe you'll be able to talk with him. And bring in that caregiver. That caregiver may well be able to diffuse the situation. In the case at hand, all trust between the staff and George has been completely destroyed by the action of one caregiver. One bad caregiver. The others may all be good, but George has painted them all with the same brush, and he's feeling very vulnerable and very angry at the moment. Someone on the staff needs to befriend him. Perhaps the administrator will turn things around by agreeing to pay for a phone for him until such time as his finances have been straightened out and he's going to be able to pay for his own phone again. Maybe that'll turn them around. We hope so. We're still waiting to see, but I believe some of the changes have already happened. But this is not going to be the last time that we have an episode from George. George, after all, has this overlay of mental health issues that's on top of his dementia that's going to further exacerbate the situation. There'll be, I'm sure, very shortly soon, we'll have another episode from George, and we'll have to go back in and deal with that, trying to get behind what that current anxiety is. But each has to be treated separately and looked at carefully to see if you can get to the bottom of it. That breakdown of trust is huge. If you think of your own life, I'm sure there, almost everybody in this room, I'm sure at some point has trusted an individual, has been let down. I mean, that's part of life. We go through life. Even our kids let us down on occasions. And our spouses, I mean, those that we love most sometimes let us down. But when trust is broken, it takes time to build that trust back up. It's a process. And with clients with dementia, you have to go through that same process. It may be a little more painful with them, or maybe not. It may be completely different. They may forget it, and before you even know, they've forgotten that they didn't trust you anymore. So every client with dementia obviously has a different response. But if you want to build trust with that client, you have to be intentional about it. If that phone is not delivered as promised, it would only make the situation worse. I want to let you know the phone was delivered. And I understand from Judith, who's here today, that he is beginning to settle down. He's beginning to befriend, or the staff have begun to befriend him, and things have certainly eased up from what they were when Judith went in a few weeks back. But the conclusion. I'm glad to say she refused. She's still with us. I'd like to open it up for questions. I don't know if anybody has any questions. We don't have the answers. I'm not suggesting that there's only one way to go. There's lots of different ways to go, but I'm giving you food for thought, and I'm letting you know how we handled a particular situation. So I don't know if anybody has anything to say or has a question about it, or shall I move on? I'll move on. So the next case. This time we got a call from an administrator from a large assisted living facility, working with a client whom I shall call Joseph. Joseph absolutely resisted taking a shower. And if any of you have worked in long-term care facilities before, then you've met a Joseph. There's always one or other that don't like showers. Because of his very offensive body odor, other clients at the facility would not sit beside him at the meal table or in the common area to watch television. So he was effectively shunned. As a result of being shunned, Joseph had become somewhat isolated in his room. He reported to his care manager that the facility was refusing to wash his clothes, which was patently untrue. He was, in fact, refusing to relinquish his clothes to be washed. When the ombudsman went to visit, they found him sitting in a chair in his room with flies buzzing around open sores on his legs. The ombudsman who visited this facility on a weekly basis knew him well and knew his family members. So what are the issues? Again, we have to ask ourselves that same question. Is this client a danger to himself or to others? What do you think? It could be argued that he is a danger to himself through self-neglect. However, that must be weighed against his right to refuse treatment. He has a right to refuse to wash his clothes. He has a right to remain dirty. However, we strongly encourage facilities to work their way through that and find a way to clean him. And his ability, we also have to look at his ability to make his own decisions. Though suffering from dementia, and this was raised by one of the previous speakers, though suffering from dementia, he had not been deemed incompetent to make his own decisions. So at this stage, in the eyes of the law, he was his own decision maker. All of us have the right to make the wrong decisions, and many of us do make wrong decisions from time to time. Hopefully not the same decisions over and over again. So, the first thing that we felt needed to be dealt with was the open sores on the leg, on his legs. Over the months, as was mentioned in the story, the ombudsman had built a very strong relationship with this client. Very difficult client who had moved from facility to facility to facility. She talked to the client about the dangers of the open sores, knowing that this client had a strong phobia about hospitals and doctor's offices. She offered to go with him to the emergency room if he would go. And he did agree. Much to her surprise, he did agree. And they went to the emergency room. She had called his sister with his permission. She had called his sister ahead of time. And the sister met them at the emergency room so she could offer her own encouragement and support to her brother. That was very helpful. The wounds were caused by an infestation of maggots. You're right. Not a surprise, though, considering he didn't like to wash. Then came the problem. They had to persuade him to stay in the hospital for a few days until they had cleaned him up. And somehow or other, the ombudsman and his sister, between the two of them, they were able to convince him that he really did need to stay there for a couple of days. I think it was extremely difficult, and I think he ended up by checking himself out. But fortunately, by that time, they had cleaned up the infection, and he went back to the facility. once he got back to the facility, the nurse at the facility was able to monitor his the wounds to make sure that the healing continued and that they were, did not become reinfected. The background of this that I want to emphasize is know your client. Know his or her background. If possible, get to know the family members. Know what the client did in his past life. What did he do for fun? Does he have children? Does he have grandchildren? What is his relationship with those children? Everything you can about the client. And again, we recommend that the same team of staff consistently work with the client so that those relationships can be built. The way each member of the that way each member of the staff will really get to know him. Encourage staff teams to get together in informal settings to have meetings, to discuss problems and successes with the clients, and to do some brainstorming on how to overcome whatever difficulties they're currently facing. Dr. Bill Thomas of the Eden Alternative and the Greenhouse Project, any of you heard of those? No? Yes, we've got a few hands showing. Dr. Bill Thomas is a great proponent of staff teams and informal meetings. And I would suggest that they are really good ideas because I think those kind of teams can encourage each other, particularly when you're dealing with very difficult clients. But about getting to know residents, I'm going to tell you a little side story that's not one of my cases here, which I just thought was delightful. It was told to me by an ombudsman colleague about a man with dementia who was in a facility, and he hadn't been there for very long. He was a newcomer, and they didn't know him. The staff didn't know him very well at this time. But he would wake up in the middle of the night and rush for the door trying to get out. And it became very problematic for them, and he's now labeled as having behavior problems. So the next logical step for the facility was they were about to call his doctor and to ask if they could get some sort of anti-anxiety medications that would see him through the night so that he wasn't doing this. However, before they did that, they started to speak to the family members to say they were having some problems. And one of the daughters said, oh, my dad, he was a fireman in his previous life. And he would wake up in the middle of the night because the alarm would go if he'd wake up and rush off to go and respond to the fire alarm. So what they did was they began to tell him, hey, Bob, it was a false alarm. You can go back to bed. And Bob would go back to bed. So medications were reverted. They got to the bottom of what was this all about? What were the behaviors about? What was behind the behaviors? And so they were able to avert putting this man on medications. So going back to my client, the one with the sore legs, the open sores, what about his body odor? We haven't dealt with that yet. I trust that at the hospital they did clean him. But now he's back in the facility again and still refusing to be bathed. So the ombudsman take is don't insist on one particular way to do anything. And I know you've had people here talking about bathing and different ways to bathe a client. There are many ways to get a client clean. What about a bed bath? This man was ambulatory, so bed bath probably not appropriate, but a basin bath. And what if you turned the shower experience into a treat? We have a couple of facilities, and I don't think they're represented here today, but we have a couple of nursing homes here in the community that have turned the shower experience into a spa experience. So once a week, every member, every resident gets an opportunity to go to the spa. They have a spa day, complete with aromatherapy with scented candles, complete with heated towels. They no longer are pushing their residents naked under a sheet with their little butts hanging out down under the shower chair to the shower room. They now have bought robes, those nice, wonderful plush bathrobes, which they drape over these, they put on them and wheel them there in a wheelchair, not in a shower chair. Big difference. I can remember being in a facility with very broad corridors on one occasion. That it was the first time I'd ever been in the facility. It was quite a long time ago. And I'm standing there, and the door in the wall next to me opens, and out comes this man. A CNA is pushing a wheelchair. It wasn't a wheelchair. It was a shower chair. And sure enough, the butt was showing underneath, the naked little butt hanging down underneath. So shower chairs are like potty chairs. They have this hole in them. draped with a sheet. And the CNA shouts, next. Dignified? I don't think so. So what made one of our facilities turn around and take a look at why, one of the reasons why this facility decided to look for alternative ways of providing the shower experience was because a resident, a woman who'd been a resident there for rehab, came into the facility, came into the office of the administrator and said, I'm about to be discharged, I'm going home today, but I want to talk to you about my shower experience. And she proceeded to describe the experience that she'd had, pretty much like I've described to you. And she said, I felt like a car going through the car wash. And at that point, the administrator said, we've got to do this differently. And they have now set up this spa experience. And the residents love it. There's nobody fighting not to have their shower. But what if an individual is embarrassed because he or she needs assistance in the shower? A male client perhaps might prefer the assistance from another man, or maybe not. But it might be a good idea to find out what their preference is. A female might certainly not want a man to do her do her personal hygiene. So find out what their preference is and then comply with it. So, okay, we're assuming that we have now gotten Joseph washed and cleaned up. But what about his refusal to relinquish his clothes for washing? Once we had a consistent staff assigned to him, and one of them had started to build a strong relationship with him, she persuaded Joseph, who obviously, along with his dementia, there's some paranoia that has set in with the dementia, so hence he doesn't want them to touch his clothes, maybe they'll steal them, I don't know what he's thinking. But once this relationship between the caregiver and Joseph had started to build, the caregiver then suggested to him, you know what, your clothes really don't smell good, we need to take these to the laundry, why don't you come with me? You can do the washing if you like, I'll just be there to help you. And so Joseph trotted off to the laundry, and worked with the CNA, and they did his clothes together. Now that happened that day. It didn't all go quite as smoothly, but at least they were able to get it done, and he was willing to relinquish his clothes. Not even relinquish them. He was willing to follow his clothes to the laundry. I can remember my mother telling me that when I was very little, I was probably less than two, that I was taken to the hospital, and I used to have a little blanket, but which had become a little square. It was as much as was left of the blanket. I sucked my thumb. And the nursing staff were apparently horrified because it was so dirty. But I don't know whether they knew that I took it everywhere. So they wanted to wash it, and I wasn't about to let it go. So they took me to the laundry, and I let them wash it, but I wouldn't let it out of my sight. They gave it back to me at the end, and I was fine. So, you know, we have to think about these things. Joseph's behavior is pretty logical by their standards. So what's the next issue? His isolation. Now that we've got him cleaned up, the offensive odor is no longer associated with him. He's no longer smelling offensive. And the residents began to associate with him more. Although Joseph preferred to eat in his room, he did occasionally now go to the dining room and sit with the other residents. He was even seen occasionally watching television sitting beside one of them. So his isolation had begun to diminish. But the ombudsman also suggested Joseph actually had quite a lot of money, and the ombudsman suggested that perhaps he should get, that his family would arrange for a personal caregiver to come in and take him out, a companion. So they did. They arranged for a companion to come in, and twice a week Joseph was taken out, which broke some of that isolation that he'd been feeling for so long. And he really enjoyed those outings. He thoroughly enjoyed them. They might go to the park for a walk. Whatever they did, there was something different every time. But at least he was out and not feeling quite so isolated anymore, in addition to the fact that he's now associating with his fellow residents. So the next issue, which kind of resolved itself. the refusal to allow the clients, the staff into his room to clean the room. The room was littered with plates with half-eaten food on, and he wouldn't allow the staff in to clean. But once they got him out of the facility with his companion, the staff could go in and clean his room. So it became a non-issue, which was good. Do we have some more time? Am I doing time-wise? You want another one? I've got one more. I put this together. I wasn't sure how long I was going to take to get through these kinds. And if anybody has anything they want to add right now, I'm happy to take any questions at the mic. But case number three. We get this from time to time. Imagine yourself, this kind of case from time to time. Imagine yourself having lived independently for however long. This particular woman was also 92. And suddenly a conservator or your family member moves you into a facility for clients with dementia that has secured parameters. Now, they may have very good reasons for doing so. Maybe not from your perspective, but from their perspective, they may have very good reasons for doing so. They may no longer be able to provide the kind of care that you need in your own home, whatever, but they've moved you. So now, after living in your home for years and years and years, you're suddenly moved into this foreign, strange environment. For all intents and purposes, you are locked in. You're in a facility with secured parameters. You're locked in. What is your first thought? How do I get out of here? Yeah. I need to get out of here. Or perhaps you're just scared and you retreat to your room and you won't come out. There's a whole range of behaviors that we see manifest at such times. And we've recently had two cases. Within the last month, we've had two cases where people have been moved lock, stock, and barrel into a facility, brand new, and put into the one was into an assisted living, the other was into a facility with secured parameters. And the one in secured parameters, we don't know how she got out. And she was gone overnight. And the police found her the next day very close to 280 miles away from where the facility was. So she'd spent the night out. Pretty dangerous. In another case, the 92-year-old woman had recently been conserved and was dropped off at an assisted living facility. She was dropped off with no personal items from her home where she had lived for 60 years. She has one change of clothes with her and nothing more. The woman, isolated from everything and everyone she knows, terrified, has gone to bed in her room where she remained for several days, wailing. Not crying like crying, but wailing, just wailing. And I'm sure you all know what I mean, wailing. The grief, the loss, the fear, you can't even imagine what's going on in this woman's head. She only speaks German. When the conservator was notified, she contacted the physician who immediately prescribed an antipsychotic. The result is that the woman is still in bed in a fetal position, still wailing, but she's now incontinent. She wasn't incontinent before the meds, she now is. So what are the issues? This is not about changing the behaviors of the client. This is about empathy and compassion. When somebody is moved into a new facility, you know, I was just talking to one of my ombudsmen the other day. When I came into this program almost 15 years ago, it was standard practice that when you put somebody into a facility, they would say to you, we don't want you to visit for 2 weeks or a month. And you'd abandon this person into this strange environment, and suddenly all the family members are gone. What a strange thing to do. I mean, now that we've moved along from there, I don't think we see that happen very often. But when you are alone, when you are truly alone, you're 92, you've lost your entire family, and you're moved, and nobody comes to see you, how scary. How scary is that? Because your neighbors probably checked in on you before. Now you don't have anybody. So it's about, this, you know, the way this woman was treated was like a dog. You might drop a dog off or to pick up a dog from the pound and take it to a new home, and there's no way to adjust that dog without the dog just seeing it through. But we're talking about a human being here. We're talking about a human being, a full, warm-blooded human being, not some inanimate thing. No matter how impaired the individual is, he or she is still whole and complete, just as she is. It's up to us to ensure her needs are met and that she is able to function at the highest possible level. In this case, it's pretty obvious that none of that is happening. If things are not turned around pretty darn quickly, she's a prime candidate to pass away within 3 months from transfer trauma. So dealing with the sense of isolation, I mean, these are ideals, but these, we cannot always just order them up to happen. It takes work, it takes effort, and sometimes you can't find the German speaker that you would like to find to come and visit her. We're fortunate, we have somebody in our office that speaks German, but that person is not going to be able to make a regular visit to visit this woman. We need to find somebody, and maybe calling the German embassy, we might be able to find someone around who's willing to donate an hour a week to come and visit this woman. That would be great. I might say that I've not necessarily put these issues in the right order. As I was putting them down, I would hope that we would have been in touch with the conservator from the get-go. The conservator that dumped her off with one change of clothes and nothing more. I might tell you that our attempts to get hold of her were fruitless. She never returned calls, and nor could the facility get hold of her. Because of this woman's inability to speak English, though she did seem to understand what was said to her, she could understand what we were talking about, but she could not respond in English. I think it's very important to bring in somebody who speaks German. I imagine that would make her pretty comfortable, or more comfortable than she's feeling right now. It's not uncommon for people that for whom English is a second language, when they go into dementia, to forget the English and revert to their birth language. The facility in this instance had already assigned a wonderful caregiver to her that was trying very hard to build a relationship with her and to pull her out of herself and to get her out of bed and out of the fetal position. But these things take time. They don't happen in flash. They take a lot of time and a lot of effort. But it's amazing what a hug and a smile can do. So always remember you're dealing with a warm-blooded person and they need to know that they're accepted, that they're befriended, that they're loved. We all need that. I put here at the bottom, communicate with the conservator. It actually should have been right at the top, but as I said, we couldn't get hold of the conservator. We'd not been, neither the facility nor the ombudsman could get hold of the conservator, and nor did we didn't have any better luck than the facility. And so our ombudsman contacted the probate court's office to file a formal complaint against the conservator. I want you to know that's not uncommon. It's really, truly not uncommon. If you find, we're talking here about a conservator, but very often we might be talking about families that are having difficulties with or communication that goes wrong between the family member and the client. And a lot of times we have dysfunctional families where families are at odds. It's probably no different than what we were dealing with the conservator. You have to deal with those issues. You might have to bring the family together to sit down and have a family conference. We've tried to do that on occasions. Sometimes it's successful and sometimes it's a disaster. So. And if you need help, there are places to go to. Conflict Resolution Center is a wonderful place to go if you need someone to come in and work with families that are at each other's throats for whatever reason. However, the call to the probate courts really did help. The conservators started to return our calls. She did bring more clothes, and she did bring some of the personal items from the house. They also talked about the medications and how the medications had affected this woman. And the physician has been called into this, and they're trying to work out a better medication that might work for this particular case. So this is all happening now as I speak. I don't hold out a lot of hope for this woman. I suspect she will be gone in 3 months, which is very sad. But anyway, that's about all I have. In conclusion, understand that progress is not a straight line. There's ups and downs all the time. Work as a team. Encourage one another. If one approach is not working, seek another. And celebrate the successes. You know, these cases that I brought to you today, each of them has multiple issues in them. You might have success with one of those issues, and the others don't. You don't seem to be succeeding with the others. But it doesn't mean you shouldn't celebrate that you've made some progress. Acknowledge the small steps as well as the big steps. Thank you for listening. And if you have anything more, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Hi, Tippy. So I don't want to blindside you with this one, but I wanted to get your thoughts on a recent high-profile case that some of you may have heard about of a gentleman in Iowa who was charged with rape of his wife who was living in, I believe, a nursing home. And right. For those of you who haven't heard a bit about this, I know about it because I was interviewed by the Associated Press to comment on this case. And I don't often get quite as anxious in an interview as I was with this because it felt like it could be misrepresented very easily. But the situation was that this was a very high-profile individual. The husband was a state senator, elderly gentleman who was running for re-election of his seat. It was a second marriage, and his wife had Alzheimer's and was living in a nursing home. And it was the children from her first marriage who were supposedly, and this is, I know this from the reporter who was interviewing me, by the way, so we'll take it at face value. And she said that she had, it was her understanding that the children hadn't really liked this more recent second marriage that was maybe 7 years old. So after she died, the husband was charged with rape. And the situation was that they believed that during a visit he had had a sexual relationship with her, and they had evidence to that effect. And prior to that, the staff in the facility had asked him to stop approaching her sexually because they believed her to not be capable of giving consent any longer. And so it was after a warning, they believe he persisted. And then after her death, the DA charged him. He was not found guilty of that. And I know that's a whole big bucket of difficult things to discuss, but I'm curious from the perspective of an ombudsman, when you're faced with issues that involve residents having relationships with one another after they have cognitive impairment, or if they have cognitive impairment, or having a relationship with someone on the outside where that individual in the facility has cognitive impairment but their partner does not, how do you wrestle with that when you're called in for your opinion?
That's a very interesting question. We get a lot of sexual abuse cases, believe it or not. Just as you have sexual predators that hone in on children, you have sexual predators that also hone in on the elderly. We had a very brief discussion in the office. I'm glad to hear that the man was not found guilty. I think when we're dealing with clients with dementia, whether or not we think they have the that they have the competency to make a decision for themselves, my understanding is that the sex drive is the very last thing to go in clients with dementia. That it's something that many of the clients have, and we see a lot of acting out in dementia facilities of a sexual nature. A lot of acting out. And facilities wrestle with it all the time. I would hope, I mean, I could answer from our perspective. We felt that the man and the woman probably were, I mean, they obviously knew each other. Who's saying she has capacity or not capacity to decide this? I mean, none of us really know that. We can only hazard a guess at that. I think this is a field that is just so charged with emotions, with rights and wrongs, white and black. You know, you're sitting on one side or the other. I don't think that we feel quite that same way in the Ombudsman's office. I went to hear a talk, and I'm hoping that the next conference, or maybe the one afterwards, that you would approach a man. He's I've forgotten his name. He's an Iranian doctor. He's with Stanford. He is phenomenal on this very subject, and I would agree with everything that he says. And rather than me answer this, I would ask you to bring him in and let him have a session here. He's absolutely phenomenal on the subject. And it's a subject that's taboo. Nobody wants to talk about.
And if you're interested in that topic, you can certainly indicate that on your evaluation. That's helpful for us as planners. If I could add one other point to this, we were also told in Nevada by what they call Elder Protective Services, so instead of APS, it's EPS, that if we became aware of a situation in which we thought there was a couple in a sexual relationship and one partner was unable to give informed consent, we should call 911.
Oh.
And we had this whole discussion about, well, what do we do with this? How do we handle this?
I would totally disagree with that. But you know, as I said, this is an emotionally charged issue, and I'm sure there are people in this room that we could probably put one side on this side and one side on that side. So I would rather you brought in an expert to really answer that kind of question than to ask what the Ombudsman think. I personally am very glad to hear that he was not found guilty. You know, we get, not too long ago, we had a call from a facility that said, oh, we need your help. Mr. Jones and Mrs. Smith are making out in the foyer. What do we do? And our response was, give them a private room. You know, that's what you do. And they have every right to do that, and so give them a private room. And we've had other cases. We've had a case where, a very similar to this case, where a husband would go, I can't remember, it was the husband that would go into the facility to visit a wife and was closing the door and having sexual relations, and the facility was up in arms. And, you know, for us, well, is she shouting? Is she screaming? Is she unhappy? No. So why are you worrying? It's his wife, it's his husband, it's, you know, their husband and wife, and if they're not visibly showing shock or unhappy, who are we to say whether they want it or don't want it? None of us know for sure. I think if there's any hint that one or the other is not a willing participant, that's a whole different ballgame. But then we get other issues. We had a case in a facility where, let me just get my facts straight for a minute, where a man had lost his wife 6 months prior. Now, his daughters were all, it was a very, very educated family. They were all professionals, dentists, doctors, whatever. I mean, there were three daughters, and they were all professionals of one kind or another. And he formed a relationship with a woman. He was in his 90s. He formed a relationship with a woman in the facilities who was in her 70s. And they would sit at the table and hold hands. And the rest of the residents called her a slut. The family was up in arms. They didn't want this to be happening. But our take was, you know, it's his life. He can make up his own mind, and so can she. We told the daughters to butt out. And they actually did. We told them they had no business interfering in his life. Well, but my mother's only been dead 6 months. That's okay. You know, that's his issue, not yours.
I wonder if this works, yeah? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Regarding the conservator of this last case you presented,
yes.
It's my understanding that many times a court appoints a conservator, and perhaps that's how you track the conservator down through the probate, right?
Correct, right.
So I would like to hear next year, or maybe if you have a few tips here about you know, the criteria for becoming a conservator who has some ethics, who doesn't just like dump off a client like a dog in a facility.
And not all of them do. Well, I mean, obviously,
a lot of
the conservators are very good.
I know, I work with some conservators,
yeah.
Obviously. But yeah, what What should we look out for in that regard?
Elizabeth, did you make a note? They'd like something about conservatorships.
Yes, please.
Next year. I think that would be a great idea. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
In fact, on Friday, I don't know if there are any conservators here, but on Friday I am going to the PFAC meeting in San Mateo County at noon to talk about this very issue.
Mm-hmm. So I attended the PFAC conference a couple of weeks ago.
So did I.
It was awesome.
Yeah. Great.
So you talked about a pretty disastrous transfer trauma, and given that this is a progressive disease, do you have any guidance or experience to avoid that? I mean, that was an obvious case, but I mean, it's going to be necessary for people to change facilities, and so what have your experiences been?
You know, I'm going to talk a little bit, I'm going to kind of switch modes a little bit. We also work with the developmentally disabled. And not too long ago, the Agnew Center in Santa Clara was closed. They closed the developmental center, and they moved all these clients who had been institutionalized for years and years and years into homes. The state did, I don't often praise the state, but let me tell you, the state did a most remarkable job about how they transferred these clients. They first took them for a day to go and visit. They met the staff, and a lot of we in San Mateo County, we had a lot of brand new facilities open to house these clients. And most of these facilities only take 3, maybe 4 clients because of the heavy duty care that they needed. They took them to meet the staff members beforehand several times. Then they took them for an overnight, and eventually, over a period of months, they actually placed them. We don't always have that kind of availability to do that. But I think if you can get somebody to go ahead of time, to see the facility, to get to at least talk to the staff before they go there, I think that is helpful. There are huge preparations that you can do for transferring a client. Let me give you my card, and we can talk about it at length. When clients are transferred, especially if facilities are closing, the licensing departments want to see what the transfer plan is. And so there's a whole way of planning for these events. There's a series of steps to be taken. So Judith, can you give her our card? Is Judith here? Does somebody have a card? Contact us, and I can put you in touch with the information you need. Yes.
I have two questions. First, what can you do after investigating, and what are your limitations?
And what are our limitations?
Yes.
Oh, first of all, we're not enforcers. We're not enforcers. We have no ability to enforce anything. We have to turn to licensing. If we can't get the cooperation of a facility to resolve an issue, we would turn it over to licensing, who are the enforcers. Facilities don't like to be turned over to licensing, so they're much more likely to work with us if that's going to be the issue. And what do we do after we've investigated?
Yes.
We monitor. We're in these facilities, as I said right at the get-go, we are in these facilities, 5,000 visits a year we make in San Mateo County. So once we think we've resolved something, we go back to ensure that the resolution is sticking. So we go back, we go back, we go back. We're in them all the time. So we'll monitor the situation. So I think I'm done. I think I'm being told I'm done. So can I take this one more?
Tippy, thank you very much indeed for talking about your issues with some of the clients. One of the things that Dr. Mirdad Ayati, who is the person you were talking about, says that if a person is sexually active during their adulthood, it's not going to change when they become demented.
Right.
The other thing is, in Europe, they do have rooms specially for such activities in facilities. And I think that's an excellent thing to do because...
I do too.
You know, why make a big deal about it? It's a natural form of life. That's what happens.
Exactly.
And
yeah.
You know, men, when they are single all of a sudden, they become supercharged. And so, and sometimes that happens for women also. But in dementia, it's not unusual.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that.